Seems, see l'amour. Si l'amour dressed in red make a man lose his head. Si l'amour. Si l'amour. Black dress on for $1,000 she wears and she moans. Si l'amour.
Yes, I understand that every life must end. As we sit alone, I know someday we must go. Oh, I'm a lucky man to count on both hands the ones I love. Some folks just have one, yeah, others they got none. Stay with me, oh, let's just breathe. Practiced on my sins, never gonna let me win. Under everything, just another human being. Yeah, I don't wanna hurt. There's so much in this world to make me bleed. Stay with me, oh, all I see. Did I say that I need you? Did I say that I want you? Or if I didn't, I'm a fool, you see. No one knows this more than me. As I come clean, I wonder every day as I look upon your face. Everything you gave and nothing you would take on. Nothing you would take, everything you gave. Did I say that I need you? Oh, did I say that I want you? Oh, if I did, I'm a fool, you see. No one knows this more than me. And I come cleaner. Nothing you would take, everything you gave. Hold me till I die, meet you on the other
I don't pay taxes, 'cause I never file. I don't do business that don't make me smile. I love my aeroplane car, she's got style. I'm a treetop flyer. Treetop flyer. Cargo that you can pay to run. The Bush League pilots, they just can't get the job done. You've got to fly down the canyon. see the sun. There's no such thing as an easy run. I'm a treetop liar. Me right. Stay down below the tree line and you'll be all right. I'm a treetop liar, born survivor. So I'm coming home, I'm running low and fast. My life, I get the ship down, I tie her fast, and then some old boy wakes up and he says, hey son, wanna make some fast cash? I'm a treetop liar, get shot. I ain't gonna die, I ain't going to get caught. You see, I'm a flying fool and this aeroplane is just too hot. I'm a treetop flyer.
This film is about one of the most talented and courageous hang glider pilots Australia has ever produced. T. Jim Travers died of a brain tumour on the 8th of December 1994, but he packed an awesome amount into his 39 years. Legend material, both the sweet and the bitter. Tim was a flamboyant showman and a larrikin trailblazer. For Tim, it was all or nothing. He had a superb athletic gift, which he combined with a fertile imagination and a plucky personality. He was the Australian hang gliding champion in 1978, yet he's remembered most for the pioneering path that he cut in freestyle. Modern hang gliders are drum tight compared to those of the 70s, which had much looser sails and a lower speed range. Yet the old gliders had wonderful handling characteristics and were ideally suited to hot dog flight close to the hill. Tim invented the concept. He was one of those rare spirits who knew no bounds. Tim in his prime was the most charming and vibrant larrikin you could ever want to meet. The creative side of his personality found outlet in painting and poetry, as well as his flying. He was a generous bloke, who willingly gave of his time and talent to beginners in a practical and down-to-earth way. Tim loved to party, and was huge fun to be around. When conditions were marginal, the grace and accuracy of Tim's flying really shone through. He carefully watched the seagulls on a ridge and figured if they could stay up without flapping, then he could too. How often was his glider seen banked way over as it skimmed the bushes, with the gulls scattering to get out of the way? If he misjudged slightly and found it wasn't quite soarable, it was no worries, because his landing skills were so truly and exquisitely bird-like. Most of the time, anyway. They called our mate Crasher Tim, but this was because he tried things that the rest of us hadn't dared to dream about, like high bank turns with a wingtip so close to the hill and so accurately placed that it caressed the bushes. Pioneering new sights with radical cliff launches. Seeing how low he could get on a ridge and still get back up. Taking off unassisted whilst lying prone in his harness and rapidly pumping the base bar of the control frame to impart a bit of momentum to the glider. Just incredible first in the world stuff. To please the crowd at Hill 60 in Port Kembla, he'd land on a crash helmet, then pass it around to supplement his meagre income. Landing on top of the Lawrence Hargrave Monument at Stanmore Park was a stunt that he could pull off with exceptional panache. I remember one day he dipped his bare toe in a salad bowl, which resulted with Tim being marched off to the Port Kembla police station. At the time, he was having a blue with a safety officer from the New South Wales Hang Gliding Association. Let's call him the Mouth. The Mouth thought that Tim was a black sheep who endangered the lives of the public with his so-called foolhardy flying style. One day the Mouth was having a picnic at Hill 60 and had set up his food on a table just behind takeoff. Tim sneaked behind the hill and weaved his wing through the lantana. As he flew over the table, he delicately dipped his shoeless toe into the salad bowl. Laugh? I almost wet myself. A public letter of reprimand to Tim was printed in the New South Wales Hang Gliding Association's magazine Sky Sailor on the 20th of April 1977. The letter said, "It's been reported to this association that on Friday the 15th of April at Stanwell, you were seen to carry out the following in-flight manoeuvre: to transfer from the normal prone harness to a position of standing in the control frame, thence to a position of hanging by your knees from the crossbar of your glider, nor was any footwear being worn for your flight." It was lucky the association didn't know that Tim used to pull this trick off at Hill 60, but there he'd take off without any harness at all, and then proceed to hang off the crossbar by his ankles, facing backwards. Hanging by his knees had become a bit too tame for the man. Tim's Harbour Bridge stunt was one of his favourite anecdotes. He'd nurtured the ambition to launch from the red light at the top of the Sydney Harbour Bridge for quite some time. two other flying mates, who'd better remain nameless, were drinking a few rum and cokes with Tim in a bar at the Rocks one night in the late 70s. However, the timing of the bridge stunt wasn't the result of a sudden drunken impulse. It had been carefully planned. Tim's choice of venue for a last supper was the Rocks Pancake House, just in case. A major Sydney newspaper had offered to pay all Tim's legal expenses if he flew in daylight, so they could film the stunt. Tim refused the publicity because he felt it would reflect badly on the association. So he chose to do the flight in darkness. Late departure from the Pancake House was necessary because of the need for minimum traffic on the bridge. At about midnight, Tim and his crew parked by the northern pylon and unloaded the glider, control frame, which was separate in those days, harness and tape deck, because Tim enjoyed listening to music when flying, like Griggs in the Hall of the Mountain King. With the help of some rope, they got the glider around the fan of metal spikes designed to prevent radicals like Tim from getting onto the painter's ladder leading to the top of the bridge. By 2 a.m. everything was ready. A gusty southerly made it difficult for Tim to balance the assembled glider, and he had to wait for a lull before he could safely launch. The launch crew, minus safety lines to prevent falling, nervously held the flight wires to steady the bucking glider. Finally, a lull came, and without hesitation, Tim went for it. As soon as he got airborne, he rolled into the most beautiful wing over and let out a primeval animal scream. He flew over to Luna Park and then headed back to buzz the cars crossing the harbour bridge. As he slowly lost height, he headed north for Kirribilli. He pulled off a perfect landing by the lamplight of a tiny harbourside park, exactly where planned. Tim got clean away with the stunt. For the rest of his life, he fondly recalled the interview he had with the police a few days later, when he cheekily replied, "No comment," to hours of incriminating questioning.
Some people seem so obsessed with the morning, get up early just to watch the sunrise. Some people like it more when there's fire in the sky, worship the sun when it's high. Some people go for those sultry evenings, sipping cocktails in the blue, red and grey. But I like every minute of the day. I like every second, so long as you were on my mind. Every moment has its special charm. It's alright when you're around, rain or shine. I know a crowd who only live after midnight. Their faces always seem so pale. And then there's friends of mine who must have sunlight. They say a suntan never fails. I know a man who works the night shift, feels lucky to get a job and some pay. And I like every minute of the day. I dig every second. I can laugh in the snow and rain. Get a buzz from being cold and wet. The pleasure seems to balance out the pain. And so you see that I'm completely crazy. I even shun the south of France. The people on the hill, they say I'm lazy, but when they sleep I sing and dance. Some people have to have sultry evenings, cocktails in the blue, red and grey. But I like every minute of the day. I like every minute of
Tim's last years were a real struggle, and he suffered, as did those who loved him. He was wounded and scarred by life and by a brain cancer that took him far too early. He was a round peg in a square world. Yet the reality of his life somehow strikes a chord with our national cultural myths about likeable larrikins. Tim's a legend. We miss him terribly, but it was a pleasure knowing him. He enriched us. Rest in peace, Tim.